Welcome to the Smart Property Investment Show with your host, Phil Tarrant.
G'day everyone, welcome to the Smart Property Investment Show. We have our monthly regular property update where I share everything about my Smart Property Investments portfolio, which we've been doing for many, many years, and I hope you've been enjoying it. If you're new to the Smart Property Investment Show, we do this every single month, as I said, where we break down, unpack, and analyze our portfolio of investments. And if you click on the Our Portfolio tab on smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, you can read all about it. So every month we get together, we have a chat. I bring in, depending on the theme of the particular podcast, a number of people as part of our A team, which would be accountant, buyer's agent, mortgage broker, and other associated people to have a discussion. And today I've brought in a guest onto the Smart Property Investment Show, Steve Waters from the Right Property Group, my buyer's agent. Steve, how are you going?
Well, mate, how are you?
Good. So today we're going to have a chat about a renovation we currently have underway on one of our properties in Kingston up in Queensland. It's part of the Loganshire, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
So part of Loganshire in Queensland, which is southeast, west, in that vicinity. Yeah, around there somewhere. We've written a lot about it, so go and check it out. This particular property, you would have heard us talk about it when we secured it, and we purchased it back in June, July of last year. And I did a podcast with Steve on the 27th of July, 2017. Go and tune in, where we spoke about the rationale for this particular purchase. So this is an interesting property. We knew what we were getting into when we bought it. And at that point in time, the conclusion was, let's just leave it because it had a sitting tenant, even though we knew it needed quite a lot of work, essential repairs and maintenance to lift up to compliance, which we undertook at the point in time, but we said we'd leave it until the tenants move out. And subsequent to that, the tenants have left, so we've used this period of time, the last number of weeks, to actually do a reno. So we're going to go through that today. But before we get there, I just wanted to put Steve on the spot. We're recording this on the Monday after the South Australian election, and we have a new government being established in South Australia, a new Liberal government after, I think, 15 years of Labor. Steve, what does that mean for us property investors, general punters? Does it make any difference whatsoever?
I think theoretically it might, but life goes on. Whether you like South Australia or not, or Adelaide in particular, of which we do, and we've been buying down there for probably 18 months to 2 years and getting some pretty good results, this type of turmoil, for want of a better word, will always stop a few people in their tracks. But I think because it's been such a long run of Labor down there and it's change, that should bring a certain degree of consumer confidence, clearly, around the area. And I hope there's some bright future days ahead for South Australia, and in particular Adelaide. And I think it will.
Before we get onto the property, I'm just thinking about this. Before we come on air, we'll have a quick chat around some, which is completely tangent, but it's all relevant and related, some major defence contracts which have been announced and are going to be announced this year. So for our listeners that aren't familiar with this, and I can chat about this because I also run a podcast around defence, the Australian government's spending $195 billion, that's with a B.
B for billion.
B for billion over the next decade on increasing the capabilities of the Australian Defence Force. So Army, Navy and Air Force. Air Force-wise, we're getting the new JSF F-35 strike fighters. Within the Navy sphere, we're getting new submarine and new frigates and new offshore patrol vessels. And just last week, there was a big announcement that the new combat reconnaissance vehicles as part of LAMP 400 Phase 2 is going to be built in Queensland, in Ipswich. So winning company there, Ryan Mattel, has slated that they are going to build a military vehicle centre of excellence up in that Ipswich area. And they're going to build 220 plus new combat reconnaissance vehicles. So they're sort of like a tank, but they're not tracked. They've got wheels on it. What does that mean for property investors? Is this good?
I think it's another part of goodness. I mean, it's not the only reason to buy into an area, but if we talk about Ipswich in particular, that's going to mean around about 600 jobs.
Yep.
Or an additional 600 jobs to the area, which is nothing but good in an already strong area. The submarine contract, which was, it's probably 12 months old, 18 months old now, isn't it?
Yeah, they haven't started building, but that's going to be they're building a
number of subs
over
many years.
Same with the new frigates that are going to come on.
Which is good for South Australia, and in particular Adelaide, considering that they've had plant closures around the car industry in and around Elizabeth, which is hopefully going to mean that some of these workers are without a job be reskilled or retooled into some of these other areas, which will still provide for the economy. So all of these major contract wins for different areas is nothing but good.
So when you talk about fundamentals, and whether you listen to this podcast or any other property podcast or TV shows or whatever, someone on stage talking about property, everyone always talks about fundamentals. So what are the fundamentals that put positive pressure or positive pressure on price growth in property?
Sorry, I'd say it again.
Positive pressure on price growth in property, Steve. And one of the fundamentals is, well, there's certain fundamentals. One is accessibility to infrastructure, so highways, freeways, schools, shops, hospitals, all this sort of stuff, infrastructure. One of the other main fundamentals is wage growth, as in are people's wages going up? And then another one is jobs growth. Mm. So what we're talking about here is that when, irrespective of its defence or any other sector, and you saw this in the mining industry, what are the things that's going to have a positive impact on people's ability to borrow money, pay down debt, give greater accessibility or greater infrastructure to areas, and jobs growth is one of them. So what we're talking about here in Ipswich is that how many jobs they're going to make?
About 600.
600,
yeah.
That's a lot of jobs, right?
It is, and it's the very beginning stages of a lift in the economy, monetarily wise. So jobs growth equals, you know, surplus income, which means spending, which makes that whole local economy start to tick in terms of its money cycle. But on the other side of the coin, though, as speaking federally, perhaps, as jobs growth rises, then wage growth also increases, and then people spend, and then inflation goes up, and then we see interest rates start to follow. So it's a very, clear cycle that just goes round and round and round. I think that the important part is to be ahead of the curve and understand what drives the cash rate, interest rates, because as an investor, that's what affects our hip pocket, and everything else is a derivative of that, including consumer confidence, supply and demand, and the like.
So as a property investor, rather than just sitting on your couch at night time, double screening, so you've got the TV on and you're also looking at your phone at realestate.com or domain.com, looking at property, it's just not looking at a house thinking, oh, that's a nice house, or that's under market value. You need to know what's actually happening in the areas where you're looking or considering to invest.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. I think, and that's part of it. I mean, you can go out and buy the nice house in an already fundamentally correct area, and you'll do all right. It's riding that wave of growth, perhaps. But if you really want to be, inverted commas, a sophisticated or an intelligent investor, you actually got to be a little bit ahead of that. And not that you're trying to predict something, but you're certainly going to where the fundamentals are going to be, such as infrastructure projects, population increases, and then starting to establish properties around there. Diversification.
So message is, if you're a smart property investor, you need to know what's going on in the local government economies, the state-based economies, how that sort of fits within a federal perspective, and understand that where you look to invest in property, you want to make sure it's going to go up in value. And why does a property go up in value? Because it's inherently connected with these fundamentals which support price growth.
So, 100%. Yep.
But anyway, we talk about it all the time, so that was a quick sort of side part, but you know, to the point of a new government down in South Australia, I'd be having a very close look at what that new government intends to do in terms of, you know, can they potentially change legislation or direction around property development, the rules and regulations around how they see their property industry growing? Yes, they can do. So just watch your space, and we'll make sure we cover it extensively on smartpropertyinvestment.com.au, so you know what's going on. Anyway, it's a portfolio update, Steve.
It is, mate. It is.
Last portfolio update I did was with our mortgage broker, where we're looking at revising some of our interest rates. So that's a work currently in place right now. And there's a number of forms on my desk waiting to get signed, switching to a couple of fixed rate products just to balance out our interest rates. And I think we're sort of shaving, 20 or 30 basis points off some of our mortgages.
It's about $400 a week.
Yeah. Mm. It's pretty good.
And it's still on your desk.
It's still on my desk.
Right.
Yeah. Stacked up. So we've got to prioritise, right?
Yeah. Right.
So somewhere where it is hurting me a little bit at the moment is I'm carrying this property in Kingston with no rent coming in on it. And I think it might have been to your team or someone. I gave them a bit of a stick the other day saying, you know, I can't carry this property any longer without tenants in there. Where are we going with the renovation? Obviously, I've leaned on you to try and help me out to get the best possible result on undertaking this renovation. I've engaged a local guy up in Brisbane to support me on this. But obviously, I turn to you and say, Steve, mate, what do I really need to do here? Why do I need to do it? I.e., I need to make sure this is 100% compliant, this property, which is essential, critical from an OH&S perspective. But what can I do? So there's need. What do I need to do? And what can I do to make it a better proposition for someone to rent? Whether that is a stickier or better tenant or someone I can eke a few more dollars out of a week to what I was getting beforehand. So that's where we are right now. It's been vacant for about 3 weeks, I think, maybe a bit longer, maybe a month.
Oh, probably a little bit longer, but yeah. There's a couple of reasons for that. But if we address the first point about what you need to do, and especially from a safety perspective, and this property was at that stage, and clearly you never want to be a slumlord. That's just never going to get you anywhere, and it's not morally correct.
No.
This property had some issues when we first purchased it, and the pest and building report revealed that there was probably a dozen or so maintenance items that were going to need to be done, of which one of them was a high moisture in the bathroom upstairs. So this is a two-story place with an auxiliary area down below.
Is that also the auxiliary area of the caravan in the backyard?
No, the caravan's, caravan was, that's separate and that's dry. That's Airbnb caravan stop.
Yeah.
So we knew that there was potentially a leaking bathroom upstairs. However, we had tenants in there and we didn't want to upset the tenants. We didn't want to disrupt the tenants either whilst there was cash flow coming in, but we did know that sooner or later we were going to have to address that and whatever else was revealed as a result of the leaking bathroom. So we went back and we renegotiated based on the pest and building report, and I think we knocked another $10,000 off the price.
You ended up paying about $280,000.
Yeah, which goes a long way towards repairs and maintenance. So the next problem, the tenants then vacated. They gave notice and they vacated. They didn't leave it in a particularly nice state. Lawns were overgrown, a bad pest problem in terms of cockroaches, fleas, just general grubbiness internally, of which we had then had a problem. So the bond was kept. We then had a problem getting tradesmen to go in there.
Did we keep the whole bond on this?
Yeah.
I was trying to remember. Yeah. We did, didn't we?
Yeah, 100%. So tradesmen would walk in there and they just walk straight out and say, look, bomb the place first, like kill the insects.
Please, yeah.
And then we'll come back in. So that was done. But finding a tradesman that could actually work within a given time frame, because all tradesmen up in Brisbane at the moment are so busy. If we go back 3 years ago, tradesmen were, you could get a dozen there to quote and they'd be ready to start the next day.
Yeah.
Now you can't even get them to quote, literally, which is a sign of the market as well.
Yeah.
For while the market is really buoyant, tradesmen become very busy. When it's slow, they're all
looking for
clamoring for work. So, you know, we've got to live with that. So we had an initial quote, and the initial quote to do the necessary stuff with a little bit of cosmetic stuff as well was around about 10 to 12,000 off memory. But as the renovation went on, we changed the scope a little bit, because it got to a stage where if we didn't do stuff now, we could band-aid a problem now and keep it within that budget, but we don't know how long it would be before we had to go back and resurrect the continuing problem. So that might have been 12 months, it might have been 12 years. So it's at that stage when you're renovating a property, you have to make the decision, do you just want to band-aid it, or do you really want to not come back to this property for years to come? So you made the decision, let's do what we need to so that we can set and forget this property. And so as a result of that, we did the bathrooms being done, full internal paint, external paint. The yards were a jungle, so somewhere in that jungle was actually quite a well-loved garden at one stage, so that's all being revealed. There's some, the bathroom problems, as I mentioned, so there was, that had ruined the bottom ceiling, so that all had to be replaced, so on and so forth, glass to be replaced and got rid of. So all up, we're going to be spending around about that $20,000.
Yeah, which is a big chunk of cash to find. This property land size is quite big. It's just shy of 800 square metres. It's a three-bedroom, one-bathroom property, so upstairs and downstairs. And go and tune in on the 27th of July. We spoke about this, 2017. Downstairs is essentially it's a filled-in Queenslander. So, you know, every investor is familiar with this. You're investing up in Brizzy, these properties where upstairs it's a reasonable sort of property, but then what people often do is fill in the bottom area. So it's not of legal height downstairs. So you can't,
it's not a livable area, no. It's more of an auxiliary storage room. I think it's got to be 2.4 or whatever it is for legal ceiling height. Yeah,
it's just shy of that. So it's a storage area, but
yeah.
I think previously someone's used it as like a home office or somewhere or other. And,
yeah, and they've decked it out accordingly. So the downstairs was another kitchenette. So very similar to the Killarney Vale.
Berkeley Vale
home many years ago that we did. So there was a kitchenette downstairs and another bathroom.
Mm.
And so what the tradesman has suggested and we agreed was to actually remove the kitchenette. So this is one of those very rare instances where, you know, less is more, taking away especially a kitchenette. But the bathroom downstairs is probably better than what was upstairs. It's actually in pretty good nick. So these are a high demand type of property from a tenant's point of view, because it almost gives them double the floor space to hang from a resale point of view, they will always do better.
Yep.
Being a high set house with an auxiliary room underneath. And even from a valuation point of view, because there's the comparables to support the fact that they will get that little bit more as opposed to, say, a low set, standard, three-bedroom, small weatherboard house.
This probably is a bit of a headache. It's, I'm not going to say it's a rabbit warren, but it's a lot of sort of ancillary bits associated with it, isn't there?
Oh, there was a shed on a caravan, on a yeah, barbecue area. Yeah, so yeah, that's all gone.
That's all gone. And there's a side bit which had additional sort of fridges and barbecues, and at a point in time it would have been a loved family home, and I think it's been sold to an investor, and I'm not going to say it's gone in disrepair, but it wasn't very well presented, hence the reason why we got a price, right?
So
so we spent $280 on this, Steve.
Yep.
That's coming up to nearly a year ago now. The market's moved a little bit over that period
the
of time.
The market's moved in terms of growth, but the rents have softened.
Yeah.
And this is we've talked about this before, but as a market grows, and especially while it grows quite rapidly, and I'm certainly not saying that this area has grown to the degree that, say, perhaps Sydney has, because that's just unusually high, Sydney. But as the value grows, investors are coming in, or home occupiers are coming in, what we find in alongside of the growth is that owner-occupiers are taking advantage of the rising price by selling. Yeah, and usually in these areas, an investor is buying. So what it does is it adds a little bit more accommodation to the market for potential tenants. So what you get is this level of zero growth in terms of rents, or even just a slight softening and as your prices rise. So this renovation is not more about, well, let's add $1 million to it in terms of its value, and let's also pump its rent up by 30%. That's not the case in this with this particular property in this area. It is now making it a very rentable and wanted property, as opposed to something that is in very plain condition, original condition, and having to reduce the rent accordingly.
So it's about giving a point of difference compared to other properties.
It's a big point of difference, which is, once again, the high sets. They give that, especially when they've got something downstairs, auxiliary room. And it's also on a larger block. It's 780-odd square metres, nice side access. And this property was purchased for the portfolio to give a little bit of added income via a granny flat if and when needed in the future.
So what Steve's chatting about then there is, say, and I'll use an analogy or example, if you've got 100 properties in a suburb, and historically there've been owner-occupiers in those suburbs, therefore there's not many rental properties, so there's a demand for rental properties, and therefore there's positive pressure on that. And then you go into a cycle where people start looking to realise the value of their increased family home or move somewhere else. So if 90 properties were owner-occupied and it becomes 70 properties out of 100 are owner-occupied, that means you've got more rental stock on the market, therefore there's not as much pressure for those rental properties. Therefore, we need to find a way to make sure that our property is rented over the other properties is rented. So therefore, we'll make this property as attractive as possible, and therefore $20,000 spent on essential repairs and maintenance to make it up to code. But then all the other stuff that makes it attractive, so people move in and we keep them, which is what we want.
Yeah, it's about the longevity of the tenant. You can have a gross high rent, but if your tenants keep changing over, it just erodes that net ability.
Yeah, and this particular product up in Kingston, so three bedroom and a bathroom upstairs, another bathroom downstairs, and some other living space, it should be quite attractive.
Oh, right? Very.
Yeah.
Especially to the larger families and in that demographic, it'll rent very easily, as long as we're within market. And this is another important point. The only reason a property won't be rented is for two reasons. A, you're above market rent, you're being greedy, or it's just below par in terms of its condition. So you need to be on market and with a good product.
So once we've done this work, that should be pretty much it for quite some time.
Well, a bit of luck.
I hope so.
Yeah, but there's a lot of other properties in the portfolio that could do us some work as well.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I've got to find $20,000 to pay for this. So, it's got to be money well spent. And it goes back to any renovation. Renovating for the sake of renovating, as in, if you're renovating and you're not going to get any upside on rent, if you're renovating, you're not going to get any upside on capital value, or you're renovating, you're not going to get either of them altogether, you shouldn't be doing it, right? A lot of people love to renovate for renovating's sake, and renovating's a headache.
Look, it's painful. Personally, I love doing it, but I haven't...
Yeah, it's good fun.
I don't have the... And so do you, but I haven't physically had the time to do it for probably 10 years. Yeah. So we have to pay people to do it, and that comes at a cost as well, because everyone's got to make money.
Yeah, everyone's got to make money. So every dollar we're spending on this then, Steve, is for a purpose.
Yeah, 100%. There's no use spending any of the dollars if it's not going to have a... a product.
Yeah, well, that's my
or a result.
Yeah, I look at it, and I've got the quote here in front of us for the property in Kingston, Loganshire. Full internal painting for both upstairs and downstairs. That's over $5,000. It's about right.
Yep.
Yeah. So I just want to go through some benchmark numbers because I get a lot of questions, Steve, saying how much should it cost to paint a house?
Look, this is a 4-hour subject, literally.
Yeah.
And I could probably speak about it for 8. When people are quoting painting, or when people ask how much is painting and it costs, there's so many variables to it. The surface condition, is it, are things straight? What's the materials? How many coats? How many colours? There's just so many variables to it. But this quote is good. The one tip I would give to people who are looking to get painting quoted is just be very, very deliberate in what you're asking for. Yeah. So, you know, ceilings a different colour from the walls. The walls are a different colour from all your trims, such as your skirts and architraves and what have you.
It's more expensive.
Don't get a renovator's paint job where they just paint everything one colour because it looks like rubbish. It'll look good for about 5 minutes, but it'll also look a little bit clinical as well.
So not all painters are created equal.
No.
If you think the quote is too cheap, it probably is. It means you're probably going to get a crap job. Some painters will just paint over where it is. They'll do no surface preparation, and then you're going to be back in the same situation. You know, you see a lot of people try and patch a roof, and they don't know very well, and you know, you're back there in a year's time because it's flaking again. So painting, the secret to painting in terms of getting a good job is preparation. The actual painting part of it is largely, you know, anyone can paint a wall, right? But it's how you prepare it is important. And I'll run through some of the other stuff we're getting done here. Replacing broken window glass in upstairs bedrooms. You've got to get that right. You know, that's a safety issue
as well, yeah.
You know, obviously work we're doing on the bathroom, you know, full yard cleaning for front and backyard, including rubbish disposal. That's nearly $1,000.
It was the Amazon. It was horrific.
Yeah. You know, and then you've got, you know, removing the old kitchen from downstairs and not replacing it. So, you know, to cut that out, you've got to cut back all the hot and cold water pipes, you know, removing the wall board, make good the damage, replace missing tiles on the floors. You know, this is just real nitty gritty, handyman type work, right?
It is.
You could do it yourself if you wanted to, but
it's also the stuff that adds up really, really quickly.
Yeah.
It's the unskilled labour, such as ripping things out and patching bits and pieces. And I call it unskilled labour because you don't have to be a sparky or a plumber to do it.
Yeah.
Or a builder.
You don't have to be licensed.
You don't have to be licensed. That's a good way to put it. It's the stuff that adds up very, very quickly. And traditionally, especially around this time of the cycle, a handyman will be somewhere between, you know, $45 to $65 an hour. So it adds up.
It does, you know, like patch hole in manhole type obstruction downstairs, remove outside structure and repair outside cladding, fit timber battens and plaster patch hole and wall set in sand. That's just, you know,
general.
Just a job.
Yeah.
You know, if you do that, that would take your whole weekend, a normal sort of bloke, right? If I was going to do
it.
And then I have to go back to Bunnings 10 times because I forgot something. You know, it's just a nightmare. You know, supply and fit vent to ceiling in downstairs bedroom. That's pretty straightforward stuff, right? Removal of multiple trees and timber frame fencing and panels. $700. You know?
Yeah. So that doesn't actually explain the full story. So the a lot of the fencing there around the house, we're not talking around the boundary, I'm talking about around the house.
Mm.
When the bushes were being cut back, they were actually glass.
Okay.
So it was like, imagine, you know, the pool fencing that you have, which is glass.
Yeah.
Imagine that, but really thin stuff. So not the safety glass. So that had to be removed because someone had just walked straight into that and cut themselves in half.
Sand and varnish floors to upstairs. Punch all holes, fill all holes in floor, sand and varnish all floor area, 2 coats floor. So we're sanding the whole top, the floorboards, and getting that done again, which is cool. So that's a good finish, right? That's good bang for your buck cosmetically.
It's good bang for your buck,
yeah,
for sure. And it gives you longevity in the floor surface as well. A really good example of what the market's doing up there in terms of trades is 3 years ago, as I said, to get your floor sanded and polished up there and, you know, nails punched and putted, all that, we're around about $1,700.
Yep.
Today, you could probably add 30 to 40% on that.
Well, it's costing us $2,200 for that, so $2,200. Remove old caravan and two and lean-tos. Remove all rubbish. So $1,800, that's a lot. And then this is the most expensive component here, Steve. As a note from the tradesman, upon further inspection of the upstairs bathroom, I found that the tiles are all loose due to tile being laid over the old masonite and the water is leaking behind the tiles and leaking in the downstairs. Recommendation to remove tiles, remove old masonite, resheet with villa board, waterproof or wet area in the floor area, retile over bath and over vanity, grout and silicon.
But
about $4,500, you know.
Yeah, so this is the stuff that you don't know until you start pulling it apart. So yeah. Without getting sort of technical, but to tile over masonite is never a good idea. There's no waterproofing behind it. It won't stick to it very well. And as a result, when you have a bath or a shower, everything gets behind the tiles, runs down into your wall cavity and then into the below area ceiling. And that's exactly what's happened. So this is where the discussion was around, do we actually spend this type of money and do it right so we don't come back to it for many, many moons? Or do we just rip the masonite off and just put that same sort of stuff back on and maybe give ourselves 12 months to 2 years or 3 years? But we weren't guaranteed.
This is preventative maintenance, right?
It's preventative maintenance, but at the top end, because we're not talking about a couple of $100s, so it's a lot of coin.
Okay. So you were at this property. You went and checked it out for me
about 3 weeks ago. Right?
Yeah. And can you see, like, obviously, when you went up there, it was prior to it being fumigated.
It was zesty.
Yeah, it was pretty bad, right? Being experienced doing this sort of stuff and operating on our behalf as our buyers actually helping us out with this type of thing, you can see the end result pretty clearly, right? You know what it's going to look like when it's all done.
Well, you know, we're not rebuilding here. It's all cosmetic. There's nothing really structural in there whatsoever. And it's the standard stuff that we've done to our own properties, you've done to your properties for the last 10 years.
Yeah. So once all done, we'll get a photographer in, take some nice shots, get it listed and rent it again.
Yep.
Prior to this work, it was rented at $350. Are we probably going to get any advance on that? You reckon it's still going to be $350?
I think it'll be somewhere around that.
Yeah.
Because remember, the market has come back and they were a large family and they were potentially paying for the privilege to be there as well, being such a large family. So we should be around those dollars, maybe a bit less.
Yeah, a bit less. Okay. So, you know, doing a renovation doesn't mean you can always increase the rent. As we spoke about, this is about making sure we actually get someone in there. So for every week that this isn't rented, $350, it's costing money, right? Mm. So yeah, $10 difference over the course of a year is, what's that, $520?
$500, yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, it's 1.5 weeks rent, really. So
compared to the alternative.
Yeah. So get someone in there as quickly as possible. So what about a revaluation once this is done? Would you recommend it?
Just see probably not yet. I'd wait. Yep. Yeah. For a couple of reasons. A, we don't need to. But what we will do is, just like we did with Berkeley Vale and perhaps North St. Mary's and Cambridge Park all way back then, is we'll, by getting the good photos of the finished product and plus all the pretty ordinary photos to begin with and the different stages of work, we'll create that document for a value when and if the time comes.
So this is important. So before and after photos.
When you do a massive renovation.
So even if you're not doing a renovation, and we're not doing this renovation for the purpose of trying to extract some equity, it's still worth documenting it. So at a point in time, you can say to evaluate, yes, we bought this property during this period. This is what it looked like. This is what it looks like right now. Hence the reasonable justification for the price increase. So this is about manufacturing equity as well as the market going up.
Yeah, this is growth and manufacturing, a bit of a combination. But just going back to the valuation, I think we've done a podcast or might have been a video many years ago now about how to get the best, or give yourself the best chance on getting a decent valuation and what the steps you should follow to do it.
Good. Okay. We'll share all these photos online when we have them. So we've got all the before photos and have a look. It just looks like a pretty standard Queensland investment property, and we'll share with the photos subsequent to all this work going down. And I've seen some interim shots. It looks really good, and quite excited about what this property will be, the end result. And, you know, just to crystallize the conversation we've had over the last half an hour is that the reason why we're doing this renovation is not to try and get more rent. It's about making sure we can have a property which is going to be more attractive to other investment properties in the market, and therefore we have a sitting tenant and a sticky tenant that's going to be there for the long term. That way we can realise the benefits of time hopefully being price growth. So yes, we've done manufactured some equity here, and we're spending $20,000. What that's going to translate into in increased equity, I can't give you that number, but at a point in time when we review this property and potentially seek to draw down some equity, we'll do so, and I'll report on that. Steve, anything else to finish up with this?
Just probably the last point is that the renovation was also necessary from a maintenance point of view.
Absolutely.
Not just from a safety, but also preventative. What we didn't spend now would have probably been four times that in a very immediate future.
And some of that stuff is just making sure that your balustrades around decks are of the right height. And
that costs a fortune, and there's no capital upside. There's no cash flow upside. It's just it's a moral responsibility. You don't even have to do it legally in this scenario, because it's a complying building from yesteryear. But from a moral point of view,
Well, you think about it, if you know, a property like this probably have young children there, right?
Yeah.
You know, if they're climbing up balustrades or climbing over, I know I've got young kids, last thing I want them sort of jumping over something, right?
100%. So, and it's a very expensive part of the renovation. We're talking probably, you know, for a couple of railings, $2,500, and that all adds up.
But you got to do the right thing.
But you have to do the right thing.
Got to do the right thing. And that's important as a property investor. It's not all about, if you're privileged enough to be able to invest in property, you need to understand that you are actually creating a home for someone else. So make sure that you are doing the right thing, you feel as though you're doing the right thing. And if you're unsure about what the right thing is, there's plenty of people out there to tell you what the right thing is. You know, you can get licensed builders in, and they should be able to do an assessment of your property to make sure that balustrades, for example, are the right height. And even if it's just rather than having horizontal slats or vertical slats on your balustrades, it's an important thing, right?
Huge.
You know, you don't want it to be a ladder, right, where people can climb up. So,
no.
You know, we need to be very, very careful. All right, good, Steve. So we'll check in with you in another month once this is all done and dusted and hopefully rented, and we'll report back and let everyone know where we're tracking with that. And look, there's other stuff in our portfolio that you're working with us on. We need to go down the next path of potential acquisition. At the moment, we're still bedding down the purchase of the 5 side-by-side units that we bought, that you helped us out with, and we've reported on that as well. So you know, it's about finessing the portfolio, and as I've said beforehand, we're just trying to improve our cash flow situation right now. So improving your cash flow situation, we've actually, you know, had to spend a bit of money here just to bed down or secure our cash flow situation by having a sitting tenant. So one of the best ways to make sure that you improve your cash flow is make sure you've always got someone in your property.
Yep, 100, easiest way.
Easiest way.
Yeah.
Nice one. Thanks, mate. Man, we go to the our portfolio section on smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. I do a blog on that. There's a whole bunch of articles. You can also listen to all these podcasts. So you can see what we're doing, and hopefully you can use it as a way to either work out what not to do or what to do. And if you want to try and emulate our strategy, that's why we put it there. But yeah, there's many different strategies in property investment. Our strategy works for us. My recommendation would be to stress test if you're looking to get into property, and work out what's right for you. And that's going to be driven by the strategy you choose to take. And your strategy is going to be based on what do you want to do with this thing at the end of the day. So that's where we go. And remember, by way of disclaimer, this is just a general chat. So before you make any decision at all in terms of property investment, investments in general, make sure you speak to a licensed professional that can support you and help you out with that sort of thing. That's it for us. We'll be back again next time. Remember to check out smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. If you like getting your info from social media, search Smart Property HQ. The guys are always posting plenty of stuff on that. If you want to come on the show, and we're always looking for guests, so whether you're thinking about investing in property, you've got 100 properties, we'd like to share everyone's story. You can contact the team, editor@smartpropertyinvestment.com.au. We'll be back again next time. Until then, bye-bye.
The information featured in this podcast is general in nature and does not take into consideration your financial situation or individual needs, and should not be relied upon. Before making any investment, insurance, tax, property, or financial planning decision, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you. Guests appearing on this podcast may have a commercial relationship with the companies mentioned.